After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending immense greetings and salutations upon the final Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, continuing our journey in looking at good moral values. Many of these values that we find, that we symbolize or we carry out, for them to be effective inside society takes a further value or certain moral concept of courage, having the courage to take the belief that the person has or these practices, to not just deliver them to oneself but to deliver them to the wider society. And this is unfortunate that we find more and more inside our society a concept of stagnation, complacency. No one wants to, as they say, rock the tide or rock the boat or change the status quo. Everybody wants to follow what everybody else is doing. Even amongst us Muslims, that we find that many of us have become content with the world around us. That life has become a la'ib wa lahu, play, amusement, enjoying ourselves, relaxation, having good times. Not to say it's haram to have a good time, or to have a good life, or to have a moderate life. But we find that for some of us, more and more, this is becoming the all-end purpose. And actually, this is amongst the minor signs of the Day of Judgment. From بين تقريبا 80 90, minor signs of the Day of Judgment that we find prophesied by the Prophet ﷺ, in شغال الدنيا, to just be worried about the dunya, taking care of the dunya, being busy with the dunya. The believers have a far more objective. The Quran, to a certain degree, rebukes those individuals. For people, you say, just give us good in this dunya. وَمَا لَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. Then Allah mentions, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. These are the real believers who say, give us good in this world and give us good in the hereafter. وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And more importantly, save us, deliver us from the punishment of hellfire. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا كَسَبُوا وَاللَّهُ سَرِيعُ الْحِسَابِ. For them, they will be given their recompense. Their reward will be given to those individuals inside this dunya and more so inside the akhirah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sari'u al-hisab, swift to bring mankind to accountability. And thus we find that the courage to stand up, the courage to say certain things that we find, a long discussion begins to take place in works of usul al-fiqh, about ordering the good and forbidding the evil. And in general, a conclusion is made that sometimes you don't need to order the good, because ordering the good or the goodness will begin to spread. It may be minute water trickling out of a tap, but it carries on flowing till eventually it benefits people. As for munkar, then it's quite the opposite. If a person turns a blind eye to it, it becomes like the fires at the moment. A small match creates a bushfire, creates hectares of lands to be destroyed, destruction. That is the method, the parable of turning a blind eye to munkar, to evil. Just let it pass inside society, that it's not for me, I shouldn't say anything, it doesn't really concern me. What difference does it make about me ordering the good and forbidding the evil? We find simple, basic ahadith, simple because all ahadith are simple in general, and basic meaning we should implement them. الجوامع الكلم, concise words. من رأى منكم منكرا فليغيره بيده فإن لم يستطع فبلسانه فإن لم يستطع فبقلبه وذلك أضعف الإيمان. Whoever amongst you sees some evil, try to change it with his hand. Obviously there's shuruq, there's conditions. Ibn Taymiyyah wrote a whole book about Amr bil Ma'ruf wa Nahy anil Munkar. But we don't want to delve so much deeply into theology that we find, because now we become a nation, a people. We're damned if we don't, and we're damned if we do. This is what the mind concept has become of many Muslims. That if you do say something, you're maybe some form of a radical individual. And if you don't say something, then just leave it, let it go by. It doesn't really concern me. We find that's why you find some individuals who are not very technical inside their lives, min al awam, just basic average individuals. You know, some of them, when they see some evil, they see something wrong, they do their bit, as they say. There used to be a certain individual, Muslim man. Every time he took his ratif, shahriyat, every time he took his his monthly salary was given to him. كان يأخذ جزء منه. You take part of his wealth and go to the grocery store, go to the shop. ويشتري المجلات والكتب. You used to buy the magazines and the books that were there. People say, what is this? What's the point of this? طيب القضية ترجع إلى الحكومة. It's the role of the government to stop ban certain books and literature, etc. inside the country. But he felt, this is my role. That from my salary, my hard-earned money, I will buy these products. My contribution. People may take offense to this. People may think, it's trivial. It's not something trivial. Because this is what, في استطاعه, this is what he has the ability to do inside his life. It's his contribution. That you never know that the person who owns the shop may stop purchasing these goods, may move away from it. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that, but his efforts that he makes may have an impact. And thus we find that the Quran is replete with ayat speaking about ordering the good and forbidding the evil. Thus we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this Muslim ummah, this nation. وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ لِلْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Let it rise amongst you a group of people who order the good and who forbid the evil. And before that, we find كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Or after that, وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. And you believe in Allah. First time Allah mentions like verse 104, Surah Al Imran, then 6 verses later, Surah Al Imran 110. That let there arise the best nation who order the good and forbid the evil. Ulama tafaseer begin to discuss this verse. Because after Allah mentions, you order the good and you forbid the evil, وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. That you believe in Allah. لِمَاذَا تَأَخْرَ الْإِيمَانُ بِاللَّهِ. Why is iman in Allah being delayed? Iman in Allah is primary for every single individual. Why is Allah delayed? It said that you order the good and forbid the evil. And you believe in Allah. Various views have been expressed by ulama of tafaseer. But some that come to mind that ulama have concluded, شَيْءَ أَهْمِيَةُ الْأَمْرِ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهِيَ الْمُنْكَرِ. The importance of ordering the good and forbidding the evil. Or the highlighting the fact that iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entails جُزْ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ بِاللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى أَنَّكَ تَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. جُزْ مِنْ إِيمَانِكَ. Part of your iman is to order the good and to forbid the evil. It's not a concept of separation that we find. The wider religions around us, that everybody is free to practice, everybody is allowed to do what they want to do. And the strange thing is that in these two pages, you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 3 times orders the ordering the good and forbidding the evil. On a third occasion, speaking about Ahlul Kitab, that you وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. You believe in Allah. You order the good and you forbid the evil. وَيُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. And you race in doing the good deeds. So here we find 3 different occasions inside 2 pages coming together, speaking about ordering the good and forbidding the evil. Is a way of the life of the believer. Having that courage, having that ability at some time to speak out. Life is tajriba, life is experience. Everyone says that, oh, when I perfect ordering the good and forbidding the evil, I will do it. No. مستحيل. All of us may نخطي ونصيب. Sometimes you say something right, maybe not in the best manner, not in the best words, maybe not the best environment. It's tajriba, it's experience. Person knows that maybe next time I should have expressed myself like this, maybe use such words. It doesn't mean that when I reach perfection, when I reach a certain level of ilm, of understanding, then I will go and order the good and forbid the evil. To remind your brother, who maybe may Allah forbid is smoking, or involved in an illicit relationship, or doing something haram, to remind him, أخي, هذا حرام. Stay away from it. It's not befitting. Why don't you pray? Why don't you fast? Why don't you do this? Why don't you stay away from that? What's wrong with that? Why have we become such complacent individuals that, no, maybe I'm going to be some outcast. Maybe I'm going to be seen like this individual always being harsh towards people. Person isn't always being harsh towards people. Person is trying to rescue people, trying to save people, help oneself. And that's the Prophet ﷺ, he gave this parable that his Muslim ummah is كَالسَّفِينَ. It's like a boat. It's a boat, it's one big journey for all of us. There's different ranks of the boat that you find, just like in today's world. A lower deck, a middle deck, an upper deck. Everyone is traveling together on that journey. That's what this Muslim ummah is. You find that the people in the lower deck, they have to continuously ask the people on the upper decks to throw the buckets, to pull up the water and bring it down to them. And to sort of excuse expression, just like today, some smart Muslim thinks, well, I don't need the people around me. I don't need the people around me. So let me just drill a hole in the bottom of this boat and I extract my own water. I survive myself. I live on my own water. What will happen? Water seeps in. They will drown. فَهَلَكُوا جَمِيعًا. Everybody will drown. Everybody will eventually drown. This is Muslim Ummah. This is life understanding that we find that, you know, I just take care of my own son. Then leave the rest of society alone. Just let it pass by. It has no impact upon me. All of us will drown. You can see the challenges as you begin to grow and mature inside this society, because many of us shabab are very naive. When your children begin to grow, they want to gain an education. They want to live inside this environment. They want to do work inside this environment. What are the challenges that we face? Should we just buckle in into our lives? Should we just take an ostrich approach and dig ourselves to the ground and leave everything around us? Children being taught what inside schools at the moment? Homosexuality, two mothers, two fathers. Hatta you find, may Allah forbid, they want to change certain concepts, say that even paedophilia is something normal. Kaif, how can that be a normal way of life to teach people something like this? And then we just begin to stay on the outskirts. Well, it doesn't affect me. It will affect all of us. Because 95% of the people inside this country is Muslim. We engage in this society. Our children engage inside this society. So to have this concept that it doesn't really concern me, I'll just save a minute percentage of ourselves, we'll save ourselves. You will not save yourselves. You will just destroy yourself and destroy everybody around you. And Muslim Ummah is one of courage, of protection, of seeking ways that you find the Sharia based on Maqasid. Read the intent of Maqasid al-Sharia as many ulama have documented. The intent isn't to save yourself. Maqasid al-Sharia is to preserve humanity, preserve human life, preserve the Muslim life, preserve Muslim identity, preserve Muslim faith, preserve Muslim relics, sha'a'ir, symbols of Islam. That's what Islam is. Preservation of them. Not to preserve your own self. That's you find if a person has to even sacrifice their own self for a greater goal, for the protection of society, then this is not something blameworthy. This is rather something praiseworthy. That a person is making the effort to protect the nations that come after them. The people that come after them, the people who came to this land who struggled, that we can now enjoy the freedom of traveling, traversing around this environment in masajid, in praying comfortably, and our family members dressing comfortably. Was that just a basic element? Or was that courage? Was that struggle of people who barely spoke the English language? And we claim to be advanced individuals, technically well-versed individuals. What's our impact on the society today? What's the impact that we have? What do we want to change inside society? Or do we just want to be standing and sit there on the side and say, let everybody do what they want to do. Let everybody carry on their normal way of life. Learn. A person learns from the mistakes of the past. Learns from their elders. Sees the future. Sees that the future is bright. Becomes part of that future. Thus you find that our intellect and mind isn't just that some people may think to upheaval society. We want to plant the seeds right now inside our mind and our hearts. Not for tomorrow, hatta ba'da 40 or 50 sana. That after 40, 50 years, you find a deep engrainment inside within our souls and the people beyond us. That we have a different vision, a different outlook, a different courage, a different belief, stronger in what we believe in, to, as they say, to get the objective met. That we may have withered away, we may not have that courage, but the future is bright to instill that. That there will come individuals who will carry that message. A stronger message that we can ever convey and carry out what we wanted to do or what we dreamt of doing inside our lives. And thus we find that the hadith of today that we find, المؤمن القوي خير وحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف وفي كل خير. The weak believer, the strong believer is stronger than the weak believer. And in both of them is goodness. You know, straight away, what is our mentality? We conclude, you know, I may as well be Al-Mu'min al-Da'if. That's not what the hadith is highlighting. That's what many for that mentality is. I might as well become the weak Muslim. The hadith is just making an expression. We find the Quran is full of numerous verses speaking about different type of individuals. Whether it be a Muslim or a kafir, there's a distinction. Whether it be the people who participate in Badr and those who did not participate. The people who went out and carried out fought in jihad and those who sat behind, who just waited there. Quran is replete with so many verses. Highlights a difference. that people who strive and struggle are not like those people who just sit there and speak about it. They're not equal in front of Allah. They're not equal identities. There may be a concept of certain ajr that could share. But the higher element is there inside the Quran. People who go beyond what is classified as limitations. Who have stronger, lofty goals and achievements. Ulul azmi min ar-rusul. Lofty aspirations. See beyond just the picture in front of them. See beyond that. Those are individuals. A'adhamu darajatan. Who have more reward. Will be given to them. Because they make the extra striving and struggling. So straight away, our concept of such ahadith is going back straight to becoming the weak Muslim. Also that we find inside this hadith that we find that it tells us to carry out action. Because the hadith continues, ihris ala ma yanfa'uka. Seek that which will benefit you. Try your best to do whatever you want to do. Wala wasta'in billah. Wala ta'jal. Seek the aid and assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't lose hope. Don't lose focus. وَإِنَ أَصَابَكَ شَيْءٌ فَلَا تَقُلْ لَوْ أَنِّي فَعَلْتُ كَانَ كَذَا وَكَذَا. Don't turn around and sit down and say, well, if I said this, I'd done this, I'd done that, it would have been like this. But rather say, قُلْ قَدَرُ اللَّهِ وَمَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. Say, this is what Allah subhanahu has destined and carried out to carry out. فَإِنَّ لَوْ تَفْتَحُ أَبْوَابَ الشَّيْطَانِ. الحديث in the Sahih Imam Muslim. Because if I'd done this, or if this happened, or if I said this, or if I'd done that, will only open up the doors of shaitan. So, carry out what you have to do. Seek all the means and the ways. Try your best. Put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The concept of decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ. There's no calamity, nothing which has been destined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which befalls upon this earth, or befalls even our own selves. Except for they find illa fi kitabin min qabli an nabraha inna dhalika ala Allah yaseer. Except for it's been documented in a book, in a record, before it even comes into existence, this world has been documented in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِكَيْ لَا تَعْسَوْ عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ وَلَا تَفْرَحُ بِمَا آتَاكُمْ وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ. Then Allah gives a response. What is the point in documenting everything? لِكَيْ لَا تَعْسَوْ عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ. You don't despair. Don't sit there thinking, well, if I done this, I done that. Maybe I should have done this. And you don't become boastful, rejoicing, except what Allah has given you. Muslim is moderate inside their life. Moderation, everything that we do inside their life is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To not to go to the different extremes that we find. And that's also that we find. عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ mu'min. Strange is the affair of the mu'min, and this is only for the believer. Only for the real believer. Something good happens, فَشَكَرَ is grateful. فَإِنْ أَصَابَتُ الدَّرَّى. If some affliction comes upon the individual, فَصَبَرَ is patient. This is only the real believer, is the one who understands this inside their life. That anything good or bad is just relative. It's only something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ultimately decreed to see which of us is going to change or use the opportunity and to be content with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, we find the famous hadith of Ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنهما يا غلام إني أعلمك كلمات. When Ibn Abbas is riding with the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, riding behind him, so close to him, he said, يا غلام, oh my beloved son, young boy, I want to teach you certain words. I want to give you certain words. What were these words? Preserve Allah. بمعنى preserve the rules and regulations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will preserve you and protect you. And then he highlighted what we want to extract. That if all of the world, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give you with something, and if everybody on the world wants to take that away from you, they're not going to be able to do it. And if the whole of the world is going to plot against you, they're not going to plot against you, except for that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is destined to befall you. Everything has been destined with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person shouldn't fret, shouldn't lose hope. Whatever happens in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of this what we're facing in the Muslim world at the moment is all hikmatullahi baligha. It's all the immense wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It really, in essence, it's an awakening. It's an awakening for many of us to awaken ourselves from this great sleep that we've entered. That's all that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, to awaken this Muslim ummah once again. It may seem harsh, in bloodshed, in turmoil, afflictions, adversity, hardships, death, etc. that we find. It may seem hard visually, but there's a sir, There's not actually a sin. There's not a secrecy. There's many secrecy, asrar. There's many secret things that lie there that will rejuvenate us once again to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, we find always being worried about people. We find actually some tradition that a person is always worried, looking at what will people say? Looking at the outcome of people, looking at the view of people. وَإِنْ تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يُدِنْ لُكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. If you obey most of the people around you, always look at the people around you, you will be misguided away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because unfortunately, the masses of people, they don't want khayr. Speaking in concept of non-Muslim, they don't want khayr, they don't want goodness. For them, you need shurbul khamr, al-liwab, drinking alcohol, committing haram, fornication. It's nothing haram for them. It's normality, it's a way of life for them. So they don't frown, they don't get worried when we address these things to them. For them, it's just a normal way of life. They just carry on in what they're doing. And the experience that they have of life, because for them, this has become normality. Some of them may awaken once in a while. Like in more of the munaf, most of them, it's just part of, integral part of their life. They don't feel offensive when you tell them that zina is haram. They just think, well, it's just part of life. It's just another form of enjoyment for them. But the sad thing is that some aqillah, some minute Muslims, it's become something for us as well. We think nothing of it. We don't want to awaken. We don't want to recognize ma'asi and dhunub and sins that we're delving into inside our lives. And thus we find that we shouldn't fear the retaliation or the words of people that we find the Quran mentions. فَلَا تَخْشَوْا النَّاسَ وَخْشَوْا وَلَا تَشْتَرُوا بِآيَاتِي ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا. Fear only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't fear the people around you. And don't purchase a small price with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's quite strange that this verse inside Surah Al-Ma'idah that we find, Allah then mentions, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Three times inside the Quran, Allah mentions three different endings that we find inside Surah Al-Ma'idah. That whoever doesn't go towards trying to encourage people towards the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that takes great courage. Whoever doesn't judge by that, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Then they are ظَالِمُونَ وَأَقَلُّ شَيْءٍ فَاسِقُونَ. Here we all understand. I studied the concept of this ayat because once again we began with the extremities. Because some of us, we fail to understand the message of the Quran. If a person speaks about hukmullah, then this person is some form of element of takfir inside their mind. Oh, ta'wil hal ayah, huwa kufr duna kufr. As an attribute to Ibn Abbas, because some ulama of hadith don't accept it. Or these ayat are known as ayat inside Surah Al-Ma'idah, speaking about Ahlul Kitab. Whichever view that you take, we've fallen short. Why have we fallen short? As we debate with one another, we fail to understand in al-hukmu illa lillah. Al-hukm is only for Allah. That's what we should codify inside our lives. Leave this issue on the side as we delve into this. If a person says that rule is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's part of tawheed, juz min al-tawheed, al-ubudiyya al-uluhiyya. No one's classifying as a fourth category. Some people try to attribute it is from ibadah, it is worship. Read modern day works of Ibn Uthaymeen rahmatullah alayhi, Sharh Usul al-Thalatha, pages discussing about rule and governance belongs to whom? To Allah. وَأَقَلُّ الشَّيْءٍ. Person who doesn't govern by the law of Allah, فَهُوَ فَاسِقٌ وَفِسْقُهُ ظَاهِرٌ. Why do we debate? Why do we try to defend what takes place around us? Person who does not govern by the law of Allah openly says it, openly delivers it, openly shows it, year in and year out. أَقَلُّ الشَّيْءٍ. Person is a fasiq, is rebellious to the law of Allah, rebellious to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why have ulama exerted their lives? Read works of Ahkam al-Quran, of Imam Qurtubi, or Ibn al-Arabi al-Maliki, ulama of Ahnaf as well. Titles called Ahkam al-Quran. Why are their works called Ahkam al-Quran? Why? Speaking about what? Speaking about rule, injunction, how to govern, how to live your life. For us, may Allah forbid, it becomes a trivial affair. Brush it aside. It's not something so important. How is it not important inside our life? Because the downfall of the Muslim Ummah is precisely this. That we've moved away. It takes courage for a person to stand up and say that we need to return back to the Quran and Sunnah in its totality, not in juz'iyyah, not in certain aspects. It takes great courage for a person to profess that inside society. It's not upheaval, it's not radicalism, things or upheaval inside society, as some people want to paint that image. No. It's a view of the Quran that whoever doesn't go towards governing of the Quran, then those people are aligning towards disbelieving individuals, towards oppressive individuals, towards becoming rebellious individuals. And that's as we began with, our life has become very limited. The way that we perceive certain things inside our life, that we perceive the sunnah to be certain elements, We perceive the revival of Sunnah is libs or libas, a shari'i, to just dress in Islamic manner, or to grow one's beard, or to wear a niqab. No doubt that is important. No one should think that I'm trying to make it trivial. No doubt. La shak fi dhalik. But some will just condense our life into that. That's all that Islam is. Where's the Sunnah of the Prophet Islam of tarahum, of forgiveness, of pardoning, of overlooking, of kindness, of morality, of goodness? Where is that Sunnah? Where does that exist? Why don't we display that? Why are we always just focusing on an external element? That's all that our life becomes. We become judgmental. This is the thing to judge certain things by. And then the opposite extreme of the Sunnah. Tajadudiyah. Sunnah is not important. A modernistic view of the Sunnah that we find, it has no relevance. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. A middle nation. Never going to extremities. None of the ulama differ. That the essence of the Quran is what? Is to judge by the Quran. Even modern day ulama pose the question, they will not differ with this. No one will differ about this. You pose the question, should we govern by the Quran or not? Everyone will answer. We should govern by the Quran. فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. What does that mean? You disagree with yourself over what affairs of your own personal dealings? Quran is beyond that. The essence of Quran, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ. You differ with the wider world. You differ with Muslims. You differ with society around you. What should you return back to? Return back to the Book of Allah. Return back to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what we should refer back to. And obviously our life doesn't always become, as some people want to portray, or all his life is just about political climate. No, remind people, you began instill inside our minds a concept that this is part of our life. This is part of our existence. This is part of our purpose. That every so often remind ourselves, just like we remind about staying away from bid'ah, staying away from innovation, holding fast to the Sunnah, holding fast to dressing like Muslim, behaving like Muslim. It's all part of Al-Islam. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أُدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَةً وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. Enter to Islam in its totality. Don't follow the footsteps of the devil. The devil is very cunning, very intelligent individual. Very intelligent, knows that if I keep people busy with certain things, then that will just keep them aside. And the greater affairs are just left aside. As everyone says today, just leave it alone. Let someone else deal with it. Let the Muslim Ummah find, climatize itself. Let it come to success itself. Let Imam Mahdi come once again and he'll give us victory. You know, all of the ulama, إذا قرأت التاريخين, you read historically, you find Ibn al-Athir, his tariq, al-Kamil, speaks about the end of time. Ibn Kathir, in his works, al-Bidayah wa Nihayah, speaks about the end of time. Shawwali al-Dahmi speaks about the end of time. Ibn Taymiyyah speaks about the end of time. You know, the difference between us and them is what? They didn't follow a life of stagnation, they exerted themselves. They all believed, Ibn Kathir believed, this is the end of the world, this is the end of time. That's what he believed in. Many of them believed it's the end of the world. That was centuries ago, but they exerted themselves, carried on. So possibly we could be living at the end of the time, the end of the world. But that doesn't mean we become stagnant and sit behind. A person needs to carry on striving to their best of their ability. And numerous other wordings that we find of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If I mention أن رجلا سأل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقد وقع رجله في الغرز أي الجهاد أفضل. If on one occasion a man came to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and he's riding beast and placed his foot inside the stirrup, he said, ask him أي الجهاد أفضل, which jihad is the best form of jihad that a person carry out inside their life. And he said to him كلمة حق عند السلطان جائر, saying a truthful word in front of a rebellious leader, a notorious leader. Imam al-Khattabi fi sharh hadha al-hadith, he mentions that annaka ta'rif annahu sayaqtuluk, that this person is going to slay you. No matter what you say, you know that the end result is going to be this person is going to slay me, is going to take away my life. But that is afdalul jihad for a person to express themselves. That doesn't mean that we go outside the buildings and go outside and create facade and corruption that we find. There are moments that sometimes a person needs to express themselves about that which is externally apparent inside our society, which some of us, as we mentioned, we just shy away from, just follow the status quo. It's nothing hidden that our Muslim society, the life it lives at the moment, and it's open. We're not talking about secrecy, what people do secretly inside their life, inside their homes. We're talking about openly out in the society. We see it, that people drink alcohol openly inside Muslim lands. They serve it, they drink it, they entertain it. We find all kinds of strange things taking place inside the environment. None of the sober. Film stars are brought over, rap stars are brought over, all types of functions taking place inside Islamic lands that never existed before. For what purpose? Or for a person to say that, well, just leave this alone, it doesn't really concern me. It's something which is open inside our society, which will destroy us in our future generations, weaken us more and more. If people don't have the courage to say, look, this is not correct inside our society. We don't accept this. As for how it will be changed, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring change upon this earth, to remove not just the ta'ghut, the tawaghut, pressing our own Muslims, our own subjects. Whatever the debate may be, we can see it, that Muslims, day in and day out, being oppressed, being slain, being killed. It should trouble the Muslim, at least to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to alleviate the suffering, alleviate the hardship. You know, we don't mind if non-Muslims are bombarding us and whatever it may be. Person can tolerate that sometimes inside their life. وَلَكِمْ مِنْ شَعْبِكُمْ From your own people, your own nation, your own comrades, your own loved ones, your own nationality, your own language, your own people around you. And you know, that becomes, as a human nature, something very difficult to bear. The ones that you love, that you cared for, and you looked after, and you served their interests, that these are the same people then that they begin to bombard you, they begin to slay and kill you, expel you from your homes, and torture you. Then psychologically, it may be easy to say, well, they shouldn't really do that. It may be very easy on the tip of our tongue. But when your home has been destroyed, when your family has been destroyed, your mother and father have been destroyed, and you're an orphan child there, and you ask the question that, where's my mother, where's my father, what do they do inside their lives? Then it becomes a total different concept, a psychological understanding of their life and how they will grow up inside their life. That everything that we loved and we cared for has been taken away from us. And thus we find this is only but Shaitan, who creates fear via the use of his allies and his friends to derail us away, take us away. Thus we conclude that many of us individuals that we read, we like to be encouraged inside our life. We find that ala ra'sim Shaykh Sam Ibn Taymiyyah. No ulama of Ahlul Sunnah, no individual Ahlul Sunnah will differ about the rank of the Shaykh. When you read through his works, Kitab al-Iman al-Wasitiyah, At-Tadammuriya, Kitab al-Iman that we find, Al-Hamawiya we find, person reads through these works and these shuruhat that we find. But you know, this is a scholar that goes beyond that. Because you read through his seerah, his life, he never just fought just with the pen. He fought with the sword. He fought against the people around him. He find most of his life remained in prison. Read his rasail. Read his letters he wrote once inside prison. ماذا يفعل أعدائي بي أنا جنتي بستاني في صدري. What can my enemies ever do to me? This is Ibn Taymiyyah when he's placed inside the seclusion, as Ibn Jawziyah highlights in Kalim al-Tayyib, inside one of his works, Invocations of God. So what can my enemies ever do to me? My paradise and my garden is right here inside my heart. وَقَدْ فُسِّرَ بِمَعَ الْجَنَّةَ أَمَّا الْقُرْآنِ Quran is inside his heart, or the good life inside his heart of Iman. If these individuals, they place me inside prison, so it becomes khalwa, it becomes devotion for me to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنْ أَخْرَجُونِ فَهِيَ السِّيَاحَةَ They throw me out the land, I become a tourist to see the land of Allah. And if they kill me, then I become a shaheed. And that's where you find that when he entered into one of the rulers of the Tartars, Khazan, he came in front of him. Because this Muslim ruler had tortured people, was about to enter into Dimashq and to just slay everyone and take it over. Tariqiyan has been documented. He wanted to do that. So the people all said that we need to stop this individual. Someone needs to go and express to this individual that what's taking place is wrong. Wala Ra'sim Shaykh Sabi Taymiyyah goes in front of this individual. And he says to him that you claim to be a Muslim. And your forefathers, who were non-Muslims, but they took care of their covenants. They took care of their subjects around them. But you, as a Muslim, look what you're doing, slaying and killing your own people. Look what you're carrying out inside, in front of your own people, what you're doing to these individuals. This individual then tried to present some kindness. He brought the food and said, present the food and the drink in front of Ibn Taymiyyah and the rest of his comrades around him. He said, we will not eat from this food. The ruler became even more aggressive. He said, how dare you not eat from the food and the drink that I'm presenting to you? Thus you find there are many narrations which are not authentic, but their meaning is there. Be careful of entering into the doors of the rulers. Because a person goes in one way, comes out another way. Because you find the mujamala, the beauty, the presentation of gifts and prizes, whatever it may be, it changes the mind concept of the individual. So he said, we're not going to eat from your food. How can we eat from the food that these animals, that they are taken from the people that you govern over? You've taken them by force. The fruits and the vegetables, you've stolen it from the people. This individual, even more angered. But this individual, because Ibn Taymiyyah had the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so some of them they write, they said that when he came out of that, they said when he was speaking to this ruler, he said that we took our garments, we placed it over our heads. That any minute now, this ruler is going to slay him. He's going to decapitate, he said, in front of everyone, and blood is going to gush out all over us. That's what his own students said. That's how we felt. That we felt scared. But Shaykh Sa'd Ibn Taymiyyah spoke the truth in front of him. He derailed him from attacking the Muslims at the time, and the ruler accepted his judgment, said to leave the people alone. And when he walked away, the ruler said, he said that I've never ever seen such a courageous man in my life. I've never seen such a courageous individual inside my life. دخل في قلبي, entered into my heart. Why? Because this individual fears Allah. Doesn't fear people. Doesn't worry about people. Has ilm, has knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knows the rights and regulations, enters with that belief, with that conviction. That's why you find Imam Ahmad that we all boast about, Imam Ahl Sunnah. Read what is the main cause, the main effect of being classified as Imam Ahl Sunnah. Ulama mentioned that if he did not stand against Khalqul Quran, many of us would have that deviant view. If not, we would have that deviant view. But because he stood against the corruption, he stood against the deviant view, expressed it clearly to the people and authority that we're not going to accept this, that changed the time. And so we just remain behind and everything becomes stagnant, then it will have a ripple effect of our society. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all fiqh fi deen, understanding the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving us all the tawfiq and ability. In whatever way, in whatever small life that we have, actually not a small life, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a precious life. That whatever we can do, whenever we have the ability to remind ourselves, remind our loved ones, remind our children, remind the people around us, remind anybody around us in a good manner. Remind them about وَذَكِّرُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ. Remind them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Order them with the good and forbid them from the evil. This Muslim Ummah is full of much khayr, much goodness. In the prophetic tradition we find we don't know where the khayr is, whether at the beginning or at the end. We still don't know. No one should say this Muslim Ummah is destroyed. There's much khayr in this Muslim Ummah. This Muslim Ummah will revive, will reawaken, will resurge once again. There's no doubt about that. There's no doubt about that. It's just moments that we exist, that we just need to encourage ourselves for our own welfare, for our own Ummah, for our own society, for our own goodness. And for even more so that we return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we can say that this is my impact. This is what I try to do to better this Muslim Ummah, try to better myself and better the people around me.